Well, thank you for coming out for the last session. I've taken the liberty of, following the protocol here of no ties as set by the Polish foreign minister. We're right on the news, which is the best phrase in my business. Today, President Poroshenko was inaugurated this morning at 10 o'clock in the Rada in Kiev. Apparently, Joe Biden made it just in time, coming in straight from the airport. He gave a speech both in Russian and in Ukrainian, saying that he wants to make to give Russians some sort of official status. He offered an amnesty to some of the armed groups in eastern Ukraine who he said didn't have blood on their hands. And he said that he wanted to reach out and hold peace talks. And lastly, he said that Ukraine was committed to joining the European Union down the road. It's a very historic day for Ukraine, but it's also a very historic day for Europe, I think, and for the whole world, and certainly the free world. At the same time, there's a reminder of the challenges facing Ukraine. A Ukrainian Air Force plane was shot down over Slavyansk. The rebels in Slavyansk, who apparently were armed, you know, picking up things from their basements, do have surface-to-air missiles. And President Poroshenko takes over without having the full control of his country, nor of his borders. So these are very exciting times for Ukraine, but immensely challenging ones as well. And I think we've talked about all these things throughout the last 2 days, but I think it's a great opportunity to sum up here. And I want to start with Jacek Saryusz-Wolski, who is a member of the European Parliament. And President Poroshenko has clearly said that Ukraine is ready to go west, as did Ukrainian voters in the May 25th elections. Is Europe ready to take in Ukraine? Where do you see the possibilities and some of the dangers ahead in Ukraine's European path?
Well, I think that if the agreement, association agreement, is completed, because part of it is already signed on the 27th of June at the margins of the EU summit, then the path is open, and it will be a very challenging path, because it's a most demanding agreement, because it will transform Ukraine in a similar way as Poland was once transformed. Its societal economic system will be rebuilt or replaced in certain areas by European Union legislation. So after a period of 10, 15 years, Ukraine will be Europeanized in terms of market, functioning market economy and parliamentary democracy. It will demand from Ukraine a lot of effort and getting away from all the bad habits and what it was, the oligarchic state, corrupt capitalism, or whatever name we give to it, which means that the society has to mature, politics have to become transparent and up to the standards of the Western world. And there has to be an efficient administration. All of those things are missing. The first step should be the parliamentary elections to have Verkhovna Rada fully legitimate and democratic without those MPs who were bought by oligarchs. So a true political democracy should be built. And step number two is eradicating to the bone corruption. And then taking over the EU acquis communautaire, roughly 70-80% of the EU laws and standards, which would lead one day Ukraine to the membership without, and I want to be very clear, any promise of membership now to be given, because it is just not feasible. Just not feasible and would be counterproductive. But by creating those facts, and this is the role of the political class and civil society in Ukraine, they should go along the path, look at the end goal, Europeanize in terms of economic and legal and societal standards. Question mark NATO. I mean, it's another topic which you did not ask, but it is somewhere behind what kind of partnership it should be, and whether it should be strengthened or replaced or complemented by US-Ukraine And the immediate task also is to strengthen the defense capabilities of Ukraine, where NATO is quite clear on that, to read the recent statement by Rasmussen and Sekgen, but where America refuses to deliver arms, which is a serious and second defense-related mistake by US. The first was to exclude explicitly any military action, and that's what encouraged Russia to invade Crimea and then eastern Ukraine. And on European side, things like selling Mistrals and flirting with Putin above the heads of Ukrainians should be stopped, which is not easy at all. So that's roughly the path ahead.
But it takes two to make a romance, and for years there's been a reluctance within the European Union that Ukraine is too big, too messy, and we don't really want to go there. Do you see, has that changed in the way that Ukraine has changed in the last 6 months? Has there been a shift in the European view of where Ukraine might fit in an EU future?
Well, I don't share this assessment of yours. I think that since there was an agreement among the member states and the process of negotiating association agreement started, it was clear that there is a will to have Ukraine close. It does not mean to have Ukraine as a member. And I think it is a wise compromise that first we create a fait accompli, as French say, I mean the state of facts, and then ask the questions of membership. I was myself the one who for the first time introduced the mention of membership into the European Parliament declaration on Ukraine in December 2004, Orange Revolution, and I did the same in March now. But all the failures and wasted opportunities by Orange elite has diminished seriously any enthusiasm to offer more. But what is on offer now is really very, very generous. I myself, negotiator of Polish association, I am jealous. Mm. Opening of the market, huge amount of money on the table, 11 billion euros. I would have dreamed as Polish negotiator of association to get such good conditions. Plus the takeover of European law and standards much wider than what we were as Poland offered in 91-94, which led us unavoidably to the membership. So Ukraine is much better treated at the point of departure than Poland or Czechs or whoever, sort of Central Europe, present members of the EU, were offered 20 years ago. And they should just stick to that and implement without pressing for promises. I would like to give them promise, but I fought for that for Poland. We didn't get it either. We didn't get any promise of membership at that stage of association agreement later on. So Ukrainians should consolidate the state, should introduce the fiscal and economic rigor, which they do under Pavlo Sheremeta, and for the first time when Yanukovych clan stopped stealing the wealth of Ukrainians, they have the 14% surplus in the budget. So they should just do what we did, roughly speaking, Balcerowicz-type reform, market reform, and market prices start being competitive on the markets. We as a union, we have offered and opened to them our market unilaterally already before signing and before the election of Petro Poroshenko. It's half billion euros a year of profit, net profit for them because of entry within tariff store market. So there are good, very good prospects, which obviously can be wasted. But hopefully this time Ukraine should overcome this temptation to wait and see, and we'll act together. I think the maturity of the society in Ukraine is much bigger than what was after the Orange Revolution. And if newly elected parliament is able to run the reformist program, if there is sufficient strength to put oligarchs, to deprive oligarchs of the oligarchic status, which means making businessmen out of them and not people who out with their own wealth buy political influence, which is contrary to the very principles of the Western world, then it may become, in 10, 20 years, a society and a country which quasi evidently and automatically will be asked or admitted to the club But today, the club of the Union, after the crisis with all the problems we're having, is not ready to promise anymore. So go to work, stop what I would say to Ukrainians, go to work, come as close as possible to Western-type democracy and market economy, and do your homework, and we, the West, Americans and Europeans, will do our utmost to help you.
Senator Paula Dobriansky, who served in the previous administration, and now you're out, is America doing enough to help Ukraine?
Well, let me put this a little bit in context, if I may. First, I'd start with the point that when you look at what has happened in Ukraine, and not only just the U.S. response, but I will put it in the context of the West response, which I think has been underscored a number of times today. It shouldn't just be the United States alone, but it's a collective response. Why is it? The first I'd point out is that when Putin made his speech, his grand speech on March 18, he laid out very specifically what his framework is for operation, what his goals, what his objectives are. I don't believe that we have offered an ideological or moral narrative and counter to Putin's remarks on March 18. It's absolutely essential, first and foremost, to do that. It's not just about also a speech or two. It is about a communication strategy that highlights and underscores the kind of pseudo-historical points that Putin has put forward, the kind of totalitarianism that exists, the kind of suppression of freedoms and lack of tolerance, and also, ironically, when you really look at, if you will, a treatment of Russians in many locations, you know, I would argue that, you know, the premise in which he puts forward, you look at treatment of Russians in Russia itself, and I think that should be challenged. So I'd start with the point, the political point, that we have not mobilized as a single strong entity of highlighting our Western values, of our institutions, and what we stand for. Second, I would come to the point that, you know, Gorbachev, if you remember, made an appeal for a common European home. We've called for a Europe whole and free. Let's be reminded of that. Why do I mention that? Because every U.S. president, whether a Republican or Democrat, has embraced this concept of a Europe whole and free. And what the challenge is that Putin has put forward is that, well, that's not the path we want to go down. He has not only stated it very specifically, but has drawn a line as to that's not what we want to be part of. So, you know, in that context, I think, of course, I think we are always open-minded as the West. We want to see things change. But I think we have to deal with also the deck that we've been dealt at this time. And in dealing with it, you have to operate accordingly. So that brings me to the third point. And that is, you had the unlawful annexation of Crimea. Its ramifications are not only for the transatlantic alliance, but let me also point out that what has taken place also has global ramifications. Countries in Asia are very concerned about issues of extended deterrence. They're concerned about what this portends for their region. And when you have agreements like the Budapest Memorandum of 1994, where Ukraine gave up its nuclear weapons and in return for its territorial protection and its sovereignty, well, what kind of a message does this send to countries like Iran, North Korea, among others? So in this sense, I would say the second point here is that this aggression, I think that we have to be very firm in having what would constitute a non-recognition policy in this case of what happened in Crimea. And we see the kind of actions that are promoted and unrest that's promoted in Ukraine and preventing Ukraine from going forward with stabilizing itself. So the other point is, it's not just only what we do in terms of countering the arguments, because we should not leave them to rest. It goes to the heart of what we in the West stand for. But secondly, we should, of course, take a course of action. The Member of Parliament here had mentioned the importance of helping Ukraine help themselves. I agree with him. I think that there should be, in the military context, military assistance and help Ukraine help itself. I also think that sanctions are very important. And sanctions, not in a reactive mode, but in a active mode. There has to be a strategy in all different sectors that would make a difference here. And let me just say one last point, because you know for me, I'm constrained by time here on this panel and a flight. I would say one of the things that we have thought about here was, well, what's the legacy of the Maidan? I think that we need to be reminded of the legacy of Maidan. What were people protesting and on the streets for? One is not only for the association, there was a civilizational choice by people to become part of the West and to embrace Western values and to become associated with the European Union. But secondly, as the member had mentioned, corruption. And here people were tired. They're tired of what their lives are like. They were tired of knowing that some $37 billion is taken from the Treasury. It's time that there's a change. And we have a role and responsibility, and that's the last piece of what the U.S. should be doing, and the West at large, is helping Ukraine. Helping Ukraine, A, in terms of these reforms, combating corruption, and B, also insisting that there is this security in the eastern and southern part of Ukraine so that there can be this stabilization and security. In other words, Russia must be a cessation of Russia's involvement and aggression in that part of Ukraine. In order for Ukraine to advance and for the promise of the Maidan to be fulfilled, in this case, we have to see both of these things happen simultaneously.
But Paula, this all sounds great, but then you look at Western policy the last few months has been several days late and many million dollars short. President Obama decided this week to give night vision goggles to the Ukrainians about a month and a half into essentially a hot war between Russia and Ukraine out east. President Putin was so isolated that he was sort of, walking around the Normandy beaches yesterday and dining with European leaders. Isn't the West dropping the ball here, in fact? And isn't the U.S., I mean, if you're saying the U.S. should be in some ways leading this as a superpower, aren't we dropping the ball?
Well, I would say, as I've indicated with my first point, no one, in my view, has stepped forward and has challenged specifically the ideological or moral narrative that Putin has put forward. He has pronounced a number of hostilities against the West at large, and I will say we are being challenged. The collective we is the institutions, the framework that we put into place post-World War II, no less post-Cold War. So in that sense, no, we need to have leadership, a strong united leadership. I would like to see more of that coming forward. I think it's absolutely imperative. There's a choice here for us. Either you don't do it and you take the consequences, which I think would be tragic for our own security, for our economic well-being, and for our welfare, or you unite and you step forward. So I think that we're going to be witnessing that this situation is not a one-off. That goes back to the point, if there are not costs to these actions, it's not a one-off. So you raise an important point. I think we need to see much stronger, firmer, and strategic action. Action that will have consequences now, but will also be important for Ukraine's development and the West's unity in the years to come.
I can't think of anyone over the last 25 years who's done more to promote or try to democracy in the world than Karl Gershman. And you were just in Kiev. How does this struggle in Ukraine fit into the larger struggle for democracy in the world now and in the past?
Well, Matt, I was struck that in the article you just had in the Wall Street Journal, you picked up on the phrase that Karl built foreign minister of Sweden said in at the meeting in Kiev we had a gathering of intellectuals, where he said that what was happening, the struggle in Ukraine, to the center of the global struggle for values in the world, and you picked up on that, but you narrowed it down to Dnipro Tusk as the real center.
A very unlikely one.
But I think that's entirely correct. I mean, Ukraine is the center of what is today an actually a global struggle. And I just want to outline a little bit about that. I mean, in the first place, you have the struggle in Ukraine. A lot of people just didn't expect since September everything that's happened. It's been historic. And what's happened in the Maidan has been, a civic renewal, a process where Ukraine is becoming a more mature nation. And I think is in a much better position now to have a successful democratic transition than it was in 2004. I mean, if you think of the history of Ukraine, the violence between World War '30s and in the 1940s, to recover from the devastation that Ukraine suffered is not an easy thing. It's not like a normal country just trying to make a transition from authoritarianism to democracy. And then on top of that, you have Putin's aggression. But if Ukraine can succeed in this, it'll be a historic transition. And I think at a time when democracy is not doing very well in the world, it's backsliding in Thailand and Turkey and many other countries, you have the failure of the transitions in the Arab, have a successful transition. It will have an impact not just in this region, in other countries that are trying to move toward democracy, but it will also have, I think, a global impact. So that's one thing. But also, as we've heard at this meeting, and Minister Sikorsky made this very clear this morning, if Ukraine succeeds in its democratic transition and you have a free and successful democratic society with tens of millions of Russian speakers on the border of Russia, it will, in my view, and I think he was saying this, encourage a Maidan in Moscow with his enormous consequences. And if it does happen, it will shift the geopolitical balance of power in the struggle over values in the whole world, because Russia is a strong, it's not as strong as it used to be, but and not as strong as it would like to be, but it is now the most aggressive proponent of authoritarian values in the world today. And if indeed you have a transformation like that in Russia, then that becomes of great historic significance. And so then the question becomes, well, what do you do? And in that regard, and I don't speak as a policy person. I run a bipartisan democracy organization, but I'll speak as an individual. And it's been said by a few people here, by Bogdan Klich and a few others, we need a policy of containment, real containment. Why? First of all, to protect Ukraine. But second, to protect the world. The Economist magazine said that, Putin has driven a tank over the world order. And other countries, as Paula just said, are looking at what's happening. And if there's no reversal of what Putin has done, you don't know what China will do in the South China Sea or elsewhere. It becomes very, very dangerous. But then, with a containment policy that obviously has to have a military dimension, obviously, but there was another dimension to containment. If you go back and remember George Kennan's famous, the idea was that if you contain the Soviet Union and prevent it from achieving global expansion of its power, it will force restraint. It will sharpen the tensions. It will promote a process of breakup and mellowing. And Russia is ripe for that today. Its economy is in horrible shape. And what's happened with Crimea is only going to sharpen the economic crisis with capital flight, with the lack of foreign investment, with the inflation, with the decline of the ruble, the decline of the standard of living. And whatever popularity Putin has today, it's going to go down. We know it's going to go down. But it obviously has other problems in addition to that. It has demographic problems, not only with a lack of growth in the population, except with the Muslim part of the population, but people are leaving Russia. A couple of years ago, the Levada Center came out with that 22% of the adults wanted to leave Russia And that number was three times higher than it was 4 years earlier. That's an enormous loss for a country. And then you have health problems. A 15-year-old in Russia will live 3 years shorter than an equivalent 15-year-old in Haiti today. In Haiti. I mean, Russia is a country with deep, sharp contradictions and bursts by Putin's aggression. So if you have a policy of containment that protects Ukraine, that defends the world order, it will also, in my view, introduce a process of mellowing and change. And we have to begin to prepare for that now. And, you know, this whole problem with, in my view, of Crimea started 15 years ago, you know, when Putin came to power. And it was really the FSB taking over in the horrible war and the murder of people like Anna Politkovskaya and Natasha Estimarova. We have to stand by their memory and these people. And remember that, you know, you have some of the bravest people in the world fighting for democracy and freedom in Russia. Putin has been able to arouse a great deal of nationalism. But if we stand by these people, and if the U.S. and the West itself can adopt a sensible policy, I think the prospect is great, not in the short term, perhaps, but in the midterm, for there to be a change in Russia, and I think that'll have global consequences.
Here's a question. Here, here. Maybe a question for Paula, or for you, Carl, and I know Paula has to catch an airplane back to the U.S. When I hear containment, I wonder, is Ukraine Greece in this analogy, or is it Hungary? And to what degree is containment maybe the right analogy in the sense that are we trying just to concede certain territory to a sort of Putin-like authoritarian space, or are we doing something proactive to...
Would you mind, Carl, if I thank you, because then I have to apologize. I'm going to depart after I give this answer. But my answer to it is, I think that containment is very much on the table. And what is its definition here? It means you pull back on your engagement. And here, the reason for pulling back, first of all, on your engagement with Russia is because of the aggression that's taken in this case. How do you and why would you engage when basically you're dealing with hostilities? Carl mentioned, of course, people who've put their lives on the line in Russia. Let's remind ourselves in the legacy of the Maidan, the some hundred who died. They died because they want to see a change. And in that sense, the containment means you are limiting and really restricting your policy engagement and actions with Moscow in this case. There are challenges to that. Let's take in the trade and the... What the sanctions discussion is about what do we change in terms of our policies and why do we change it? I think Carl is absolutely right. I think policymakers, that should be front and center in terms of the discourse. There has been an attempt at dialogue, and dialogue hasn't gotten us anywhere. So containment is definitively on the table in this context, as far as I'm concerned.
Thanks, Paula. But Carl, you know, from a Polish point of view, containment was not the best policy. For this country over 45 years?
Well, look, containment was always misunderstood, and I understand that it could become a defensive purely a defensive policy, and Reagan then turned it into something more offensive. But the idea of change within the Soviet Union was there from the very beginning. Obviously, we need other dimensions to this policy. We discussed this morning the ideological dimensions, and, you know, the very fact that now we can support people in Russia who are fighting for freedom of that. And I think we have to be very, very conscious of that. But the reason why I think containment is a valid concept is not only to protect Ukraine and to defend its east, but whereas in the past, it could be said that the Soviet Union sought global conquest and therefore had to be contained, and that by containing it, you would sharpen the contradictions. Today, the global dimension of this is world order. In other words, if Russia is permitted to get away with Crimea, then the old rules no longer hold. So there is a global dimension to having this policy. And, you know, you have to be able to say that that is not permissible in the world today. Otherwise, I think everything that the United States and Europe have assumed for the past 25 years is dead. Now, they may feel that an explicit policy of containment is provocative. But I think, you know, Sikorsky was right this morning when he said, what provokes is weakness and not strength. Then the question becomes, you know, the point that Steve Hadley was making this morning about holding the door open. Yes, we do want to hold the door open. But I'm really regret to say that we're not holding that door open for Putin to walk through. It's not Putin. He represents something different, and we have to recognize that. It was 15 years ago. It was something different. It's just very, very hard for me to think that in any fundamental way he's going to change. And what will change is that if Ukraine becomes a democracy, then the idea of Putinism, the system of Putinism, which is based upon the idea of the illusion of expansion of Russian power, great Russian chauvinism, and so forth, that is dead. Because, as again, it was said this morning, Russia can't be an empire without Ukraine. So I'm not shy about talking about this dimension. I understand for diplomatic reasons people might want to, but I think a policy of containment, if properly carried out with all the instruments we have, with information and the now democracy assistance and so forth, that ultimately that will allow Russia to become part of a Europe whole and free.
Right. Before Zbigniew said that, it was Lenin, I think, I'm paraphrasing, said that Russia without Ukraine is like a body without a head. Perhaps on that note, I think it's important to bring in a Ukrainian perspective in Ievgen Vorobiov. Maybe I'd like to get a sense of, you know, what is your sense? I mean, how do you feel as a Ukrainian today with Poroshenko taking office? Is this optimism, worry, all these things?
You know, I'm moderately optimist about the situation in Ukraine right now, and not only about Poroshenko's election. That is definitely a good thing, but I think for the other reasons that are usually mentioned in the press and in the expert discussions as well. I think in terms of domestic politics, the election of Poroshenko was incredibly important in that he received the majority of votes in Western, Central, and Southern Ukraine and received the most votes in the majority of the Eastern precincts. So that was the first case in the long history of Ukraine where one candidate received the support of basically the whole territory of the country, bar those that didn't participate in the election because of the separatist threat. In international terms, I think Poroshenko's re-election is important because we have already a leader in Ukraine who can make credible international promises and to deliver on his international commitments. So he is a credible interlocutor to foreign governments. And I think Russia understood that by trying to send Zarubov, the ambassador, back to Kiev. So I'm very, you know, positive about those sides. I'm not that positive about the actual composition of the government because many old members of the previous allies will probably come back with Poroshenko. But that is a problem for Ukrainians, not for the international community so far, because the Ukrainians will be pushing for the snap parliamentary election, and that will be a big chance for actually refreshing the elite in the country. That said, I think it is always important in analyzing Ukraine not to fall into this temptation of looking at the present moment, but try to make a step back and look at the situation in a more strategic perspective. So if we look at Ukraine 3 months ago, we would see a country with destroyed institutions, a country which lacked functioning army and security services, a country which had an invasion in one of its regions, and later an invasion in a different region. 3 months later, it has an army which receives more money from the budget. The expenses for army have been increased by 50% in comparison to consequent decreases in the past 2 years. We see some first combat experience of this army in eastern Ukraine in the situation which is far from the peaceful anti-terrorist operation as the government claims it to be. But it is a combat experience which is absolutely crucial for that army, indeed. So I think if you look at these changes that Ukraine has gone through for the past 3 months, we have some reasons for cautious optimism. That if we talk about military security, because I think the security was a theme of our panel. If you look at the energy security, for instance, you also can say that Ukraine escaped the most troublesome, the most pessimistic scenario of getting its supplies from Russia cut off and the population of the country rioting against the increased gas prices. The government attempted to do pretty wisely in that situation, and I think so far has succeeded. So energy security is also very important in the strategic dimension, of course. The government is talking about delivering on its commitments within the European energy community, for example, splitting the gas transit operator into two, and those are positive signs. I think what is less optimistic, if we talk about the energy security in Ukraine right now, is understanding whether the promises that Poroshenko is making about the decreasing of gas consumption are underpinned by any real policy plan rather than this attractive rhetoric. And I think that is, of course, important to discuss with the international partners plans for increasing Ukraine's energy efficiency, as the panel yesterday discussed.
Right.
So I think those are the main reasons why I'm fairly optimistic about Ukraine's matters in the coming months.
I mean, I was in Ukraine for a couple of weeks recently, last week, and I had the same feeling in Kiev and in Lviv, and then I flew out to Donetsk and took a little drive around through Horlivka up to Yankeva and then to Lugansk and back to Donetsk, and I went through several checkpoints. All of them were by the DNR, the Donetsk People's Republic. It seems that Ukraine, and I saw hundreds of men with very heavy, serious weapons, that Ukraine has lost control of a significant chunk of the East. Do you think it's realistic for them to get it back, and how?
I think it is still realistic. Perhaps not overnight, but given the wise policy of applying sticks and carrots, and given some time, Donbas could be won over. Not without huge concessions, unfortunately, not without more human casualties, because I think the battles will go on. But that is possible. I think the crucial task for the current government is to understand what price it is prepared to pay for ushering Donbas back to Ukraine, whether it is ready to pay the local chiefs for assisting in that return of Donbas, or it intends to fight for Donbas on its own terms. And I think that is an answer, that is a question to which Poroshenko will have to present an answer in the coming month.
Well, I understand the question in the panel title is not only how to build new Ukraine, which we are talking so far, but about Ukraine as a pillar of European, and I would say Euro-Atlantic security, so externalities of the Ukraine situation. And continuing your words on containment and your question, I would say containment, yes, with all arguments I agree, but we need a second C, contamination of post-Soviet space by successful Ukraine, which means contaminating by democracy and functioning market economy or Western standards, if you wish. And this will be the biggest contribution and emission, in fact, of Ukraine to the North Atlantic or global even security dimension. Obviously, you refer to Brzezinski, and it's a fundamentally right that Russia without Ukraine has no chance to become an empire or to re-become an empire. So if we contaminate post-Soviet Russian space And one day, if there is a successful Ukraine in terms of democracy and well-being, ordinary Russians will ask, why can't we be the same, I mean, democratic and enjoying prosperity? What has been done so far by Putin is a lasting damage to the principles of international law and principle of non-violability of frontiers, which should not be forgotten, because I'm afraid that now, with this Putin slide back off, which is game or not, that the West will be tempted to say, oh, we are relieved and let's sit together again. And then the consequence is not yet fully assessed for the non-proliferation of nuclear arms. Are there any guarantees any longer for Korea or Japan or any other actors who might have or might wish soon to have nuclear arms? But by the fact that there would be such a positive demonstration effect of successful Ukraine if for Russia is strengthened by in fact the assessment that Putin has done a big damage not only to the world peace and principles, but to Russia itself. First, economy is going down. Second, it's forced he's selling cheap gas to China. Third, EU is giving up or tries to give up addiction to the Russian gas. NATO has finally been reactivated and found again raison d'être. And the European Union is going to rearm itself and put stress, which is part of this question, America, Europe, burden sharing, to spend hopefully more on defense. So with all the tragedy in Ukraine and all great effort ahead of them, I think that at the end of the road, we might be benefiting from this crisis, because there will be more peace and security if we change, we the West, we Europe, you America, Ukraine obviously, and Russia on the way one day, when? To democracy and respect of universal values of international society.
But if a free Ukraine poses this fatal threat to Vladimir Putin, the first question is what would we be negotiating as the West, as Chancellor Merkel wants, about with Vladimir Putin? And why would Vladimir Putin de-escalate or take the off-ramp or whatever phrase people like to throw about?
He won't. He won't. No, I just don't think it's possible. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't continue to push forward and continue with this process. I would like to find a different word than contamination.
Ukraine virus.
Positive.
I mean, it's sort of...
Democracy projection, let's call it.
The contagious spread of democratic values. Yeah. The contagious spread of democratic values. And, it's probably worth just stepping back for a moment and thinking about what's happened over the past 25 years. I was in this city in early November of 1989, when we had a big meeting sponsored by the Polish-Czechoslovak Solidarity Foundation to try to encourage change in neighboring Czechoslovakia, because it was right near here that the Czechs and the Poles would meet on the border in the mountains. And in any event, Havel later called it the prelude to the revolution in Czechoslovakia when he came to speak to the Polish parliament here. And immediately after that success, the Polish groups, understanding with a historical perspective the need for a safe neighborhood, started working in the region to try to improve and encourage democratic change in the region. And then 20 years later, we had a meeting 500 kilometers to the east in Lviv, focused on the Eastern Partnership. And this is a process. It's a process that I think is moving to the east. It is going to continue to move. I have no doubt that it will. The question is how painful it is going to be, what role the West plays in this. It could be, Radek Sikorsky could have been right this last night when he said it could take a Syrian course. It is very, very dangerous. And you hope that Putin has given us a wake-up call and that we will rise to the occasion. And I think, this meeting has been interesting to me, because it's clear, and you had a lot of fairly sophisticated policy people here, people whose voices are heard. From the U.S. point of view, bipartisan. I thought the discussion yesterday between Senator McCain and Senator Murphy was quite remarkable and very important. And there is a kind of a bipartisan consensus that's emerging. It's not penetrated fully Washington yet, But I think in the it will, because I think there's just so much at stake here. And I just think we have to keep pushing and understand that the way the communists used to say, history is on our side here. You know, it really is. And I just think we have to have confidence.
I want to open up to the panel to questions from the floor, if people can raise their hands. And let me just, as you think of something, let me just throw something to Ievgen. What's truly changed in Ukraine? As you say, you know, it is the same faces. Petro Poroshenko has, danced with everyone on that political scene. He was one of the founders of the Yanukovych party. What is going to prevent this from being another disappointment of one of many that the Ukrainians have had over the last 25 years?
I believe that's a clear realization that whenever a certain group of oligarchs or a certain branch of power or a certain group of officials tries to usurp the power, that immediately leads to a crisis in Ukraine. In 2004 we saw this attempt of privatizing a major steel mill and then having a union of two elites, Dnepropetrovsk and Donetsk elites, to seal the election of their candidate, and it failed. We got a peaceful revolution, but still this attempt failed. Now we had an attempt of a person who clearly didn't have the means to build the authoritarian states to do so, and this attempt also failed. So I think a number of crises in Ukraine's history must have taught Ukrainian elites, be they oligarchs, be they representatives of these administrative cadre, they understood that it's impossible to seize control of the country's financial flaws, to seize control of the political power, try not to share it. So I think that is the crucial change that the Euromaidan has brought to Ukraine.
And I guess they have such a great media now and a civic sector. I mean, it's also the first election that I've ever seen where people vote for Poroshenko and the next day, it seems the majority goes into opposition. We voted for you because we want you to implement what we decided is the national consensus. And if you don't do this, the Maidan can very easily reconstitute itself. Are there questions? I'm sorry, I can't see people very well, but yes, here on the left, and perhaps we can take one here on the right, these two.
My name is Ivo Augustinski, I'm from Wroclaw University of Economics, and I would like to ask you one question, because you very nicely described how enormous threat is this what is happening in Ukraine for Russia. You mentioned Brzezinski's words that it's impossible for Russia to be an empire without Ukraine. So it means that it is the most determined person who would like to change, who is most interested in the situation in Ukraine is Vladimir Putin. So could you describe more pessimistic perspectives of close future of Ukraine, because according to what you are saying, it's very optimistic, but you know, they have democratic.
Got it. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
So, on the right too, and I think that's a very good question to look at sort of how things could go wrong.
Anita Szobiak, the Polish Institute of International Affairs. I would have a question to Mr. Saryusz-Wolski, because you were urging us to keep to the externalities of the Ukrainian situation. So steering the debate a bit towards the European Union, what do you think the lessons can be drawn from the crisis in Ukraine for the Eastern Partnership? Even before the crisis in Ukraine, there were already voices increasingly calling for a reform of the Eastern Partnership. Now, with all these events in Ukraine, there are probably even more reasons to rethink this policy. Do you think there is a need for such a reform? And if yes, then what are the major lessons from Ukraine? Thank you.
Please.
Okay, the reference to the first question. The negative scenario is the opposite of the positive one. So the question is easy. I mean, it's briefly speaking, Yugoslav scenario. I mean, the Ukrainian elites and society is immature enough and does not stand up to the challenge and wastes this chance, and Ukraine continues to be kleptocratic, corrupt, disorganized, governed by divergent interests, unable to defend itself, not reforming its economy, going more into the debts, and so forth, and so on, and so forth. I mean, there are various grades and shades of these negative scenarios, including the Russian factor. I mean, Russia continues to interfere via those hidden interventions by GRU-led commandos, and there is a permanent instability of the type we had, I mean, Bosnia-Herzegovina type situation, probably not, but in the worst case scenario also, the Serbian-Croatian type Srebrenica scenario. Very simple, and most unwelcome. On Eastern Partnership, and then Ukrainians and we, the West, should do everything for the positive scenario to happen, imagining the negative one to counteract and anticipate. On the Eastern Partnership, I mean, many said that it's dead. So quoting Mark Twain, those rumors are premature. It is alive. I think that there will be a second youth, or a second young period for Renaissance of. It is a good concept. It has had two weaknesses. Perhaps they were unavoidable at that stage, but at that stage we should make corrections. So my answer to your question, yes, we should change. First, I remember long discussions with people on the Commission who kept denying to us in the European Parliament that it is a geopolitical adventure. There's nothing on geopolitics, just a technical DCFTA, a little bit of some other elements. While it was fundamentally a geopolitical plan, de facto it was read as such, and rightly so by Putin, a clash of or promotion of Western civilizational model to the East, with consequences and grave ones and profound, as we spoke, for Russia and his dream of creating the Third Rome and the Eurasian civilization himself. So it should be admitted easily, openly, that it is a geopolitical, not a plot against Russia, but it is a proposal of civilizational change, insisting that there is a sovereign right for everybody, including Belarus, I am looking at Mr. Milinkevich here, and Georgians and others, to make the free choice in terms of values and standards of the society in axiological base. And the second thing to change is the instruments. I think that the with all the good things which I said before about the generosity of the association formula, I think that behind the policies of EU and US, when we say security, we say calm and stability in Ukraine. I think that we should have much more dynamic concept of, it is not just calm and stability, because the highest calm you find in a cemetery, we want a dynamic, vibrant democracy there, with contagion, not contamination, or value projection eastwards, which means that we have to change the instruments. We have to make this process much less bureaucratic and much more societal, which means that we should build all the bridges between the societies of the West and the society of Ukraine to provoke the profound societal change, and not just administrative, which will be very, very hard, because Washington bureaucracy and Brussels bureaucracy will have unavoidable, I mean, obvious temptation to limit. And my recipe is every part and parcel of the structures of our societies in the West should find their counterparts there and make bridges and twinnings and whatever, so that de facto this society first, Ukraine and then others, becomes part of the Western world.
I think the Yugoslav analogy is very bracing, although I guess if Putin is in the role of Milosevic, Milosevic did end up in a pretty bad place and remained dead. Yeah, and maybe do you want to sort of raise the question of reasons to be skeptical, perhaps ones that we haven't mentioned that might concern you?
I'm afraid that at some point, by trying to confront Putin, Ukraine will not, you know, produce its own Putin. I'm looking at the surge of patriotism in Ukraine, which is admirable and indeed very, very positive development to me. But I'm afraid of this constant discontent of Ukrainians with the current parliament. If we cannot appoint, if Ukrainians cannot appoint re-election of the parliament, and with this growing distrust towards the parliament, they will seek more the reliance on the executive. And in this situation, if Poroshenko, for example, attempts and succeeds in providing for some positive change in the first couple of months of his presidency, he might further boost his support. And I'm not sure whether that will be positive for Ukraine in the long term.
It's a very good point. We have time for one last question. If please go ahead. Maybe one more over there, very, very quickly. But please keep it very short. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Cordelia. I'm a student at University of Warsaw, and I also write for a Georgian investment magazine. So my question is, looking at the title, which isn't up there right now, but making the change in Ukraine a pillar of European security, and listening to the two preceding questions, what if it fails, what if we can't help the Eastern Partnership, is it at all dangerous to tie European security and European values to these things, seeing it how precarious they really are right now? Any of the panelists think that's dangerous?
Thank you. And one over there. Just. Behind you.
Irina Kishashvili, University of Wrocław. Short comment about the terminology. We are speaking still in the end of the day and we are mentioning Ukrainian crisis. I would like to repeat, we did not have the time in previous panel when we had to think about and speak about the definition. Like, what do we mean? Like, how many people more do we need to be shooted and killed in order to call some other word, whatever is happening in Ukraine right now? The people are shooting every day, and the number of IDPs increasing in hour by hour. And we all were speaking yesterday about increasing of military budgets of neighboring states, and we are still calling it the Ukrainian crisis. What do we consider under the crisis? Or if we do not consider this is a crisis, let's call it something a bit clear, like we consider intervention, occupation, or what? Thank you very much.
Carl, do you want to start? And this will be
yeah,
done.
Well, I don't have the term off the top of my head. I did like contamination, and I, you know, let's find a better term, but frankly, it is a crisis. And, you know, referring to the last question, you know, I can see an extended guerrilla resistance in the East, and I can see the failure of the Ukrainian transition, the failure to deal with all the problems that the Maidan wanted corrected. And I think that would be an absolute disaster for Ukraine not to take advantage of the opportunity of the Maidan to really solve these problems. I see a lot of forces on the other side. You know, the almost consensual election of Poroshenko, the fact that Ukraine has a stronger identity, the fact that there is a Maidan to put a check on the government. You know, I just remain hopeful. I was thinking last night at the dinner, I don't know how many of you were at the dinner with Ruslana, and I said to myself, if I were Putin, I'd be very fearful of something like Ruslana. I mean, who was able to arouse such spirit, such emotion, and such mass feeling. And there's a great opportunity now. I just hope that the West can take a message both from the Maidan, the values that were affirmed at the Maidan, but also the seriousness of the danger posed by Putin, and just rise to the occasion. I don't think there's any more serious challenge facing the United States and Western democracy today than what's going on in Ukraine.
On the first question, I think that European security is tied, whether we like or not, to the situation in the East, be it South Caucasus or Ukraine. So there's no question whether it is tied. I think the conscience of this strong interlinkage is growing and will be growing further. On terminology, I can easily show you in the documents and resolutions of the Parliament. We never call it, or sometimes we call it crisis, but you'll find there invasion, aggression, and hybrid war. The three terms being used for description of the situation by the European Parliament, institution of the European Union. So we're not hiding away the war, aggression, invasion, as much as we continue to call the invasion what happened in 2008, when Russia invaded Georgia. So we call it by name. Perhaps you refer rather to the terminology being used in the media, which maybe you're right. I mean, it is a war. It is a new war, which perhaps political scientists should describe, that you can have a war without tanks rolling into a country, but by this hybrid war, which is done by intelligence, media, misinformation, cyber attacks, and so forth. It's a new war, new type, but it is a war. So perhaps you're right that we should be more clear on that. But in the formal documents of the Union, it's invasion, aggression, and hybrid war.
And last to Ievgen, and I know it's hard to top Ruslana, and I don't know how good your voice is to render the Ukraine national anthem, but we'll give you the last voice.
Thanks. I think the question of terminology is indeed very important in terms of how we frame the current situation and how we then prescribe a policy action. I think the sheer coverage of Ukraine in the media is so that everyone tries to come up with a more precise definition, and then we are lost in all these dozens of words used. You can say proxy war, you can say hybrid war in Ukraine, but I think if we look at the Russian perspective, what Putin is thinking about this situation in Ukraine is more of a special operation. So for him, this is a clear-cut operation whereby he has certain goals and he has resources, and he expects to get as much result as possible from this instability that the insurgents create in the East. So I think that is something that we have to keep in mind, that for Putin, perhaps the invasion, direct invasion, was not a goal to begin with. And perhaps we were fighting the wrong kind of beast. So I think Ukrainian authorities are also a bit puzzled with the use of terms, especially when they talk with the journalists, because they stick to the anti-terrorist operation. And that also creates some domestic problems, because it implies to many people in Donetsk region and in Lugansk region that the people who support the militant separatists are terrorists themselves. So I think the government in Ukraine is also falling into this terminological trap by trying to use this term all the time, and then basically antagonizing the population in those regions who are not the militants, but still do not have trust in Kiev government.
That's a very good point. Well, join me in thanking the panelists, and thank you for having the stamina to make it to the last one. Thank you.